Glaze transparency is pretty straightforward. It's not all that complicated. Glazes are glass, and glass can be transparent, which means light can pass through it. And even if it has a color, light's still passing through it. You can see the clay body behind it. Or glass can be opaque, which means light doesn't pass through it. It doesn't really change anything except for the visual read of it. The color shift, because opacity reads as white in glaze chemistry, so it makes things pastel. So we can see a clear glaze here with cobalt and an opaque glaze with cobalt, and they're slightly different shades because the opacity. And that's pretty much what we got. And, you know, if you've got glass in your life, glass windows, glassware, you know, it can be transparent. There's not that much opaque glass out there, but there's plenty of opaque glazes. But then there's this. What is this? I mean, if you've been in ceramics for a while, you've probably seen this before because it's one of the most popular glaze effects out there. But a lot of people don't know actually what it is. And I mean, just visually, what in the holy acid flashback black light poster of the surface of Jupiter is this insanity? All the streaks and the movement and the swirls and the different colors. And what if I told you it's just one glaze? Like, literally just one. It's not layered, it's not anything. And it's actually a pretty consistent, common chemical reaction that we have complete control over. And we can make work and we can make not work. We can make it more intense and less intense because this is phase separation. And today, let's talk about what it really is. Hey everybody, I am Matt from Ceramic Materials Workshop and welcome to Cracking the Kiln, our opportunity to dive into what is really going on in our glazes. So this effect, phase separation, most likely you've seen it. It's very, very popular as an effect because it's kind of wild. It tends to have the streaks and variations in color, and it'll go transparent over here and opaque and streaky over there. And yeah, it's really wild and exciting. A lot of people will call this break because it will tend to build up more where it's thick. And that is true of phase separation. It does tend to like to be thick. So you'll see it in embossed areas or lips or anywhere where the glaze really builds up. Really, actually, that's just thickness variations, and phase separation definitely likes to be thick. It's got nothing to do with the texture. It has nothing to do with cooling or even the firing as a whole. You can make these happen in really normal firings. There's really nothing any particularly special about it. It's just this one particular chemical reaction that makes this effect happen. So phase separation is occurring because of actually that difference between transparent and opaque. Because phase separation is actually the transition between a glaze being transparent and it being opaque. It doesn't happen gradually and evenly. It actually happens in pockets. And those pockets are what phase separation is. In fact, we're seeing, although we only have one glass, there's literally only one recipe for this glass, that when it melts, it actually splits into two different chemistries of glass. And one is transparent, and that's sort of quote unquote normal glass, and one is opaque. And as they come together, they sort of intermingle and mix. And it's sort of like pouring milk into water. Like, you know, at first there'll be all streaks and swirls and craziness, and then eventually it just goes completely and utterly opaque. And glass is pretty much doing the same thing, making that phase separation reaction. Now, it does have a couple of parameters to know, and one of them is that it is always going to be a blue shade. It's not like intensely blue, but there's definitely a bluish hue to that phase separation in all forms. Now, you can add other colorants to a phase separated glaze and get some interesting reactions. You can add copper, and because copper is normally going to make a green, and you add in to a phase separated glaze, and that phase separation is going to be opaque and blue, it makes it more of a seafoamy turquoise type color instead of the straight, you know, more intense green of copper. My personal favorite is to add into manganese. Manganese it's a brown, but it's definitely like a red brown. And when you mix it with the blue of phase separation, it makes things more purple. And so you can get really, really cool effects for it, but it is always going to have that blue color. And we'll talk about that when we talk about some specific types of phase separated glazes. You may know, but it is important to know that it is going to be blue and it is going to be opaque. The other thing to really know about phase separation is the thickness part of it, right? Phase separation definitely occurs more on areas where the glaze builds up, lips, edges, embossed areas, throwing rings, those types of places. Anywhere where the glaze is either going to get thick because of the way it builds up in the application or the way glazes run when they melt, because they'll tend to pool up in one area. Phase separation has that blue streakiness as it's moving towards opacity. And so what happens is when you have a thinner part and a thicker part, the thinner part will be the transparent glass. And that'll be like in this one, it's brown, right? And that's a really well-known effect for phase separation. But as it gets thicker, it gets blue. And so it makes the pots seem like crazy and surreal if it's blue and it's brown and it streaks and it's totally wild. But you don't need the texture to get this. That we really need to be clear. It has nothing to do with texture whatsoever. You can get phase separation all over a pot if you control your application thickness and your chemistry, because you have to get both of those in line. It's sort of a nice, happy accident that, you know, when you do have a lot of texture, and handmade pots do tend to have a lot of texture, that glazes will pick up that phase separation naturally without doing a lot of work. But you absolutely can get phase separation on a nice, even surface. And we've seen those. We'll see a few more of those. But it really is just about getting them thickness. People like to give us a hard time because when they see our test tiles don't have any texture. And they go, oh, that's not realistic of what glazes do. Actually, it's completely realistic of what glazes do, because glazes need to have thickness as a consideration. We have multiple faces on our test tiles, so we test them thick and thin so we can see homogeneously what a glaze is going to do. When you have texture relying on that, you create what we call a rational thickness. That's when you don't have any control of when the glaze is thick and thin, and that's not a really good way to understand what that glaze is doing. Could it do it sometimes? Yeah, but is it going to do it all the time? Well, it depends. Did you apply it that thick or this thick? And you don't really know, whereas really mastering your application is going to give you a much better relationship with that phase separation. The phase separation of itself, that term does come from the fact that we've got two different compositions of glass and they are separating, right? They're actually trying to be very separate. This cartoon version of phase separation shows us essentially what's going on, that we've got these two different formulas of glass interacting. Now, they are different chemistries, and this leads some people to be concerned that phase separation is not durable. We've had some friends who do lab-based durability testing, and they found that the glazes are just fine. There's no correlation between phase separation or lack of durability just because it's two different glasses. Those two different glasses actually are pretty stable as long as it's well-composed and well-fired, and that's the case for any glaze. But that effect that we're seeing is this intermingling of those two glasses, which give us the cool streakiness that we're looking for. The term phase in and of itself actually comes from this concept. Those of you who've been around glaze nerds will have seen this before. And if you haven't, this is called a phase diagram. And a phase diagram is a scientific document that tells you what happens when you combine different molecules and heat. They'll tell you that certain proportions of molecules will do this, and other ones will do that. This phase diagram is specifically silica, alumina, and calcium. And what it says is, if you've got more silica and alumina, you'll form mullite. And if you add in a certain amount of calcium, you'll form a northite. If you add in even more calcium, you'll form lime. And that's what chemistry is. Chemistry is all about the proportion of different materials. Those different compositions are phases. We have phases in glass, and they're just attempting to separate. What's more relevant for ceramics is actually understanding why we get phase separation from a chemistry perspective. Now, to do this, we have to look at Stull's map, and this is not a video to get into Stull's map. If you want to learn all about Stull's map and how to make the most of your phase separation, join us for our online classes and workshops. We will get into this and so much more. But in short, phase separation exists in what my wife and I, Rose, define as a microregion on Stull's map, a place where certain effects happen, and they happen very consistently because it's a chemical reaction. It's just telling us that you get this much of this and this much of that, you're going to get this. And that's just what the phase diagrams tell us, and we can find that on Stull's map too. And that's a really important thing of our research, is we've been looking and finding all of these microregions on Stull's map for many years because Stull's original map didn't do it. It was a very specific document for the time. Now, you don't have to believe me that this is where these glazes exist on Stull's map with this very high silica and low alumina. We actually can see it in our recreation of Stull's map. From here, we're going from 0.4 alumina down to 0.2, and we're going from roughly 1.5 silica up to 5.5. Now, we can see in this map on the left-hand side, we've got a bunch of transparent glazes, and as we move over to the right-hand side near that phase-separated microregion we marked out, that in fact, you can see the phase separation, the streakiness, and eventually the glaze going completely and utterly opaque, because the phase separation is the transition between the transparent version of the glaze and the opaque version of the glaze. It's literally just the thing in the middle and happens to give us this really, really amazing effect. Now, if you've been around phase separated glazes or you've made your own, one of the things you may believe is that you have to have titanium for your phase separated glaze. You absolutely do not need to have titanium for your phase separated glazes. All those glazes I just showed you have zero added titanium in them. But titanium can be a benefit for your phase separated glazes. I like to describe it as adding salt to caramel. You don't need the salt in the caramel. It's gonna be sweet and creamy and delicious without it, but you do add a little bit of salt and mwah, perfect. Wonderful. And that's what titanium does. It really enables phase separation to be less sensitive to things like thickness and application and those types of variables. And it just makes it much easier to get the phase separation that you're looking for. Titanium, there's a couple of different sources. The main one is titanium dioxide, or tie-dye as we call it around here. That's what we use all the time. We like it a lot. The other one you may have heard of is rutile. Rutile is just a naturally occurring titanium dioxide with about 10% iron contamination. It's fine. A lot of people like it. I prefer tie-dye. I always go for the pure thing. The interesting thing about phase separation, though, is that it does expand that microregion. That's part of the reason why people believe it's so imperative to have titanium in your phase separated glaze. It takes that very small region on Stull's map and it just makes it a lot bigger, because one of the classic things that you may have experienced if you've tried to make a phase separated glaze on your own is oftentimes they don't work. It's usually because of variation in the chemistry of the materials versus what you've got. And we can fix that and solve that. But titanium sort of, you know, gives you a little padding on that shortcoming. And so it makes it a little bit easier and it can juice up the phase separation just a bit. There are several types of glazes that you may have heard of that are actually just phase separated glazes that are known as a type. The most famous one is the floating blue. And floating blue is known for having this appearance where it's brown where thin and phase separated where thick. That phase separation is blue. And so you happen to get this sort of surreal transition between brown and blue. And even though it's one glaze, and that really breaks people's brains, because like, how is one glaze both brown and blue at the same time? Well, now we know. It's just phase separated and the phase separation is naturally blue. Some people will add a little bit more cobalt to pump up the blue in it a bit, but really that's the end of the day, that's what it is. Just an iron phase separated glaze and it's gonna go blue where it's thick. And again, there's a ton of floating blues out there and you know, some of them are better than others, but they're all doing the same essential thing. The other name that you may have heard of for a phase separated glaze is Chun glazes or Chun glazes. Those are both different versions of the same word, from what I'm told from my Chinese speaking friends. And Chun glazes are an ancient Chinese tradition of a phase separated glaze. What they really are is that they are celadons and copper reds, which are historically reduction fired Chinese glazes that are phase separated. So with a celadon, those are more like a light blue, and then you phase separate, you add in the milkiness, and it's just a more pale version of the blue. The copper reds are a little bit funnier, because oftentimes Chun glazes you'll see like this, where they have them called, it's called the kiln's kiss. Really, they're just splashing the copper red on to the phase separated celadon and the phase separated copper red. Some more extreme examples like this, though, are kind of crazy, because the glaze goes purple. Now, this breaks a lot of people's brains and it makes you go to go, well, I thought you said it was a copper red. Why is it purple? Well, color theory, my friends, because copper reds are red, right? Phase separation is blue. If you know your color theory, what happens when you mix red and blue? You get purple. And that's why you get phase separated copper reds turn into a purple. And so you get these two different Chun glazes. There are some contemporary Chun glazes, actually quite a lot of them, where people use that term for oxidation glazes. That's fine. For me, that's another discussion as to cultural appropriation of the name. They'll use them for cone 6 and cone 10 glazes that are just phase separated. Oftentimes they'll add copper into them, but actually it's to get the blue-green color, because copper and oxidation is green and then the phase separation is blue. And so you'll often see these have this name of Chun. It's just trying to mimic the ancient Chinese reduction glaze, but you know, it's all in good fun. It's all just making different phase separated glazes. glazes. The other type of glaze you may have heard of is a Nuka glaze. Nuka is a Japanese tradition of phase-separated glaze. And again, a lot of times people have this really different perception that there's something really weird going on here, because a lot of Japanese glazes will use ash, like wood ash or plant ash, in their recipes, and they'll think, oh, that's something really different. Yeah, plant ash is just silica and alumina and calcium and sodium generally. It's all the same stuff that all of our regular materials are made out of. It's just coming from a different source. And I think Japanese potters have a different philosophy about the use of ash, like it's sort of needed. It's not, there's nothing wrong with it, but I can totally make glazes using ash that are phase separated, like a Nuka. I can totally make glazes using ash that are just transparent, like a normal glossy glaze. So there's nothing really all that special. That said, there is a ton more to know about phase separated glazes, but we've got to go deeper into the subtlety of the chemistry for all of that. If you want to know more about phase separated glazes, please join us online at ceramicmaterialsworkshop.com. That is our place online to teach all about how glazes work and why they don't, diving into real chemistry for real working artists. So people like you can learn all of those cool chemical tricks, because no matter what you've heard, glazes are definitely chemistry. If you do join us at ceramicmaterialsworkshop.com, we've got a bunch of new offerings. First and foremost, we have started offering our online workshops and classes in Spanish, both spoken and written Spanish. We are so excited about this. Right now, you can get our middle glazes course, all about cone 6 glazes, or our class Crystal Ball, all about the chemistry of crystalline glazes, in Spanish. Soon, we're gonna have our introduction to clay bodies class and our understanding glazes and advancing glazes classes, all in Spanish. We are so thrilled to finally be able to put that up there for you. And for all of our friends who are speaking other languages, we're gonna work on those too. It's just Spanish first. Also at cmw.com, we have subscriptions. Ceramic Materials Workshop is your greatest resource for all glaze information. We are the greatest book ever put out. Thousands of hours of information and tests and more than you could ever imagine. And you can access it all with our subscription program. You can find out all about that at ceramicmaterialsworkshop.com. If you just can't get enough of listening to us, we've got our podcast For Flux Sake with me, my wife Rose, and our partner Kathy King, being smart and dumb about glazes. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like. Please follow and subscribe to us. Please share this on your social media and tell all your friends, enemies, and studio mates about CMW. It really helps us to grow. And if it's within your means, please support us on Patreon to allow us to keep doing all of this for you in the glaze community, to keep making your work better. And last but not least, I'm gonna throw it over to my wife, Rose, to announce the winner of our glaze naming contest from one of our previous videos.
We have a winner. In our latest episode of Cracking the Kiln, we explored the science behind Bristol glazes. And we asked for your help naming our glaze. And wow, all your submissions were amazing. And after much deliberation, our winning name is River Avon, submitted by Ludwig. Well, why River Avon? Well, because it's the river that flows through Bristol, England, and it's the home of Bristol glazes. So if you want the full history behind our glaze, check out Cracking the Kiln. And for all the juicy details on all things ceramics, like, subscribe, and follow us at Ceramic Materials Workshop.